This is the first page of the Telegraph Act of 1885. It has 8 footnotes that show that it has been amended, reinterpreted, and expanded over the course of the last 138 years. Welcome to The Hindu. I am Arundeep. This act was passed by the British Raj for telegraph cables, but today it is one of the main laws looking at India's internet and mobile connections. There are 2 other laws, but the most recent one was passed all the way back in 1950. Together, these 3 laws regulate all telecommunications in India. Now things are changing, with most opposition MPs expelled. Last December, Parliament passed the Telecommunications Act of 2023. This repeals and replaces these 3 laws and brings all of telecom regulation essentially into one single act of Parliament. Now, most of the Telecom Act actually takes regulations that have been passed in one way or the other by the government and by the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India and brings them into one statute. For example, there is a guide that the government publishes every few years called the National Frequency Allocation Plan. Now, telecom networks use a range of different frequencies to communicate, and the NFAP says which bands of spectrum can be used for what purpose. For example, telecom networks have to bid for spectrum that is essentially reserved for them to buy. And police radios and defense networks, they use spectrum that is allocated to them administratively. And Wi-Fi is unlicensed. This mic that I'm using right now, it's a wireless mic and that is unlicensed. I don't have to get government permission for this mic to talk to its receiver. And it's also why you don't need to get government clearances for installing the internet at your home even if you're using Wi-Fi. Now the NFAP is part of the act. Similarly, there was a case where the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India passed an order a few years ago saying that all telecom operators have to maintain a do not disturb registry. Essentially, if you sign up for this registry, telemarketers cannot call you. They are essentially banned. And now this requirement has been brought into the Telecom Act itself. There are lots of things like this where a regulation that was passed in the past has now been brought into the main act. The word license has been changed to authorization, and there are a few other changes like this, but largely the structure of telecom regulation is mostly intact. We spoke to Harsh Walia from Khaitan & Co. and Raman Chima from the International Digital Rights Advocacy Access Now to unpack what the consolidation of this act entails.
The Telecom Act brings a lot of clarity and statutory backing to many issues that the telecom sector was facing. The act clarifies is that the act empowers only the central government to take action along with the state government, of course, or the municipality, if any seizure or sealing of telecom network over a property is required. So it is not that any authority can come out all of a sudden and confiscate any equipment or any telecom network. So this gives a big relief to the telecom service providers. It also clarifies that the property tax cannot be imposed on telecom network deployed in a property. So property tax will only apply on the property and not on the telecom infrastructure like a telecom tower. So these were pain points for the industry.
One thing about the Telecom Act is that a lot of it depends on what is called subordinate legislation. Essentially, a lot of orders, directions, and notifications will start coming out from the Department of Telecommunications, and that is where policy changes can actually happen. The Union government doesn't need to go through Parliament to issue these because in the Act, it has given itself the powers to act on its own. We spoke to Raman Chima about the concerns this kind of approach can lead to.
It's not a new radical progressive document. This is actually, in a sense, building on the colonial era Telegraph Act that India had. And details often do require rule making by the executive branch under the route of delegated legislation, which is when you have rules that are supposed to be prescribed under a law passed by Parliament, but that power to frame those rules is given to the executive branch to frame later and to share a copy with Parliament. My view is that it's better for more content to be in the primary law, looked at by the people's representatives, clear for everybody so people can also note unforeseen consequences, drafting mistakes, or perhaps areas of new technology that may not be factored in, and put that in the main act itself instead of leaving it for the civil servants to fill in later.
A previous draft of the Telecom Act would have allowed the government to license apps like WhatsApp. And the current version doesn't do that anymore, but activists are still worried that it could happen. That's because the definition of telecommunications is pretty vast. It says, the Act says, telecommunication is transmission, emission, or reception of any wired or wireless message, whether or not such messages have been subjected to rearrangement or computation. Here's what Raman Cheema has to say on that definition and what it could mean.
It is very clear that anything that essentially runs on a telecommunication service, including the data layer, you know, whether it is large services like Gmail, Google Search, Meta's different services, including Facebook, messaging platforms to WhatsApp, to small things like Wikipedia, a small startup music service launched in India, or perhaps an Indic language recipes website, all of that could still be regulated by this law. They've just chosen to not explicitly do so in the beginning. And what they're doing in effect is they've armed themselves with that power and they're saying we're forbearing ourselves from using the power for now.
Another thing that bothers activists is that the government has largely left surveillance untouched. Now, in India, the government does not need a court order to tap your phones. All that's needed is an authorization from a senior government official at a secretary level. The last time surveillance rules on telecom networks were reformed in any way was in a 1996 Supreme Court case that was filed by the People's Union for Civil Liberties. And this was 1996, so there were no mobile phones in any significant quantity even around in India at that time. We spoke to Chaitanya Ramachandran. He's a lawyer who has written a paper on how surveillance laws were essentially frozen after this 1996 judgment and what that means for the state of tapping into phones and internet connections in India.
The PUCL judgment basically dealt with telephone tapping. And the court said two important things. The Supreme Court of India, in deciding PUCL, said two things. The first is they recognized that a right to privacy does exist with respect to telephone conversations. And secondly, they laid down additional safeguards to reduce arbitrariness in the issuance of interception orders by the central government and state governments. But it's also important to note two things that the PUCL court did not do. The first is that the petitioner PUCL had actually asked the court to strike down Section 5(2) of the Indian Telegraph Act 1885, which is the section that gave the government the power to issue interception orders. So the court refused to strike down Section 5(2), and as a compromise, it said, we're not going to strike down the section, but here are some additional safeguards that should help to reduce arbitrariness in the process of issuing interception orders. And the second thing that the court didn't do is, which was also asked for by the petitioner PUCL, is it did not agree to impose a procedural safeguard of prior judicial scrutiny. In other words, the petitioners brought up this idea of any interception order should be based on a warrant issued by a judge. And what the PUCL court said is that we can't do that because the parent statute doesn't make any reference to prior judicial scrutiny. Now, although the PUCL guidelines were intended by the PUCL court itself to be a temporary or a stopgap kind of measure, technology has fundamentally changed since the PUCL judgment. So, you know, that judgment dealt specifically with telephone tapping. And within that universe, it was only, PSTN telephones. Like, this was the dawn of the mobile era. So the court didn't even really consider the tapping of mobile telephones at length. PUCL court looked at this issue. They felt that the time was not right to impose a procedural requirement of prior judicial scrutiny. Maybe it's time to revisit that idea and, you know, bring in the idea of it shouldn't be the executive branch, whether it's a secretary of the central government or a secretary of the state government. These are ideas that have been passed down to us from the times of the British Raj. So that's another reason why these ideas, I think, need to be revisited.
In the coming year, we will see how the Telecommunications Act is implemented when the government starts framing rules and regulations and starts releasing them to the public. Until then, thank you for watching this video. For more such news and analysis, please watch The Hindu.